my dear brothers and sisters in Christ. On the Feast of Nativity, we celebrate the birth of our Lord Jesus Christ. Jesus is God's gift to the world for the salvation of humanity. In giving us Jesus, we also come to realize the nature of God, that God is not just one. It is not a solo monad existing all by himself. In God, he realized through Jesus that he is a trinity of persons. The Father who sent us his Son, and his Son who gave us the Spirit. Therefore, in God, we are celebrating the Trinity of love. It is because of the Father's love for humanity who saved us. He gave us his Son, Jesus, in order for us to understand the meaning of love. So truly in God, when we say that God is love, we do not mean that God loves himself. In a way, many of us love ourselves selfishly. In God, because it's a trinity of persons, the Father and the Son and the Spirit, they are unceasingly loving each other all the time. The Father loving the Son, and the Son loving the Father in the Spirit. And it is in this context that today we celebrate the Feast of the Holy Family. For this is your theme, God's love in the community. You know, my dear brothers and sisters, this is very important. Because of Jesus, we come to know that the Father is a trinity of persons in a community of love. Every family that takes after the name of our Father, therefore is called also to be that community of love and of life. And that is the reason why, my dear brothers and sisters, the Church makes it clear that in every marriage must be open to new life, open to procreation. A marriage is not just between a man and a woman loving each other. This is precisely what is happening in the world today. Many in the world are reducing marriage merely to companionship and not open to the gift of new life of creation. And when marriage is reduced to companionship, the couple is turned into themselves instead of turning to the world. And it's important because the fruit of every marriage is really a child. And when the couple loves only each other, that love eventually will die. Because when husband and wife are absorbed in each other alone, that love does not give life. Any authentic relationship will be life-giving and will be fruitful. Even for those couples who are childless, those of you who are singles, we are called to be life-giving all the time. Even childless couple, you are called to be like this priest. We are not married, but we are also life-giving because we continue to give ourselves in love and service to humanity. So no one therefore is exempted from living a fruitful life. And this is so true when marriage is reduced to simply companionship. That's what the world is doing today. That is why you can have same-sex union, you can even marry a dog, if that is a good number in some countries. It's companionship. But marriage precisely must be fruitful so that we can bring love to the world. Marriage has to do not just with the couple, but why that is no need to solemnize your marriage in the registry even. Why? If you just love each other, why must you go into this special service solemnity in the registry of marriage? It is between two men and two women, there is no need to. Precisely, marriage is not just a sacred religious, like it is a social commitment, because to bring children to society, the state has a duty to make sure that the marriage that is undertaken will bring about responsibility in the raising of children, because children will affect society. And no, my dear brothers and sisters, today when we set the Feast of the Holy Family, therefore, the Feast of the Holy Family presents to us Joseph, Mary, and Jesus. They were not a rich family. Joseph was a carpenter. He was not wealthy. In fact, he was poor. That's why Jesus was born in a manger, not in a palace. And when Jesus was presented in the temple, they used a pair of other doves, symbols for the poor, in offering to the Lord. And yet, the Holy Family, they were happy. Why? Because happiness in a family is not how rich you are, not how beautiful you are living in, which big house you have, which big car you are driving. That will not bring happiness in the family. Otherwise, all the rich people in the world, the happiest family, they should be the models of family, they are not. In fact, we watch the TV drama, all the big issues, big ones, all the rich people. Korean movie, Chinese movie, all the rich people always fighting. The family is breaking apart from the poor families. It's people who are deeply in love. When there is forgiveness, when there is acceptance, when there is support, when there is encouragement, when there is affirmation, that's what's important is in this second reading. You are not saints, you are called to live a life of humility, to forgive one another, and to build your family in love. My dear brothers and sisters, this is the kind of family that all of us are deeply longing in us. That is why when we see beautiful families, we realize how far, how short we have exchanged ourselves, we have changed ourselves. This is truly a family, doesn't have to be rich, doesn't have to be famous. So long as your house is a place of love, of forgiveness, of support, your child will be happy. Your spouse will be happy. All the other things, they can add and sometimes distractions. My dear brothers and sisters, it is true. Today we have faced many challenges in family life. It is not easy. That is why I always say to all of you, I don't envy all who are married, those of you who are parents. It is extremely challenging to raise children today. So don't think, I never think that my life is easier than yours. And don't think that your life is easier than mine. We all have our crosses to carry, whether as priests, whether as married people, whether as parents. But the challenges of raising children today is really complex and daunting. Very, very daunting today. But it's not only today. I suppose every history has its own challenges. The return of Mary and Joseph, they too were poor. And they had to fled to Egypt, as we read in today's gospel, because they were under persecution. And so we just imagine Egypt 300 miles away from Palestine, in a foreign land, they were refugees, basically. Just imagine Joseph was asked, how do I make a living? How do I ensure that Mary and his foster son, Jesus, would have enough to eat? So challenges are everywhere. Challenges from within and challenges from without. Today the gospel is very revealing because two persons are mentioned in the gospel. We have King Herod and King Archelaus. King Herod is a symbol of pressure from political powers, from social pressure. This is why families today are being threatened from without because of political and social pressure. Many families are succumbing to what society is imposing on them. Society is changing the rules. Society is redefining marriage and family life. Today, marriage is no more considered sacred. Now these people get married up in the sky on top of Mount Everest, under the water, about the meter below. They want to get married. They think it is a fun thing. It is nothing to do. It's a social event. It's something that is to thrill people, to make fun. And it's not sacredness of marriage. We forget that. And that is the reason why also you find that today the external threats are many. And this separation between companionship and fruitfulness in marriage is really also caused by advancement in science and technology. Because of science and technology today, procreation and companionship are separated. Today we are talking about social link freezing, IVF, surrogate motherhood, which means to say a baby can be born outside of the mother. We don't need the mother anymore. And all these things means to say therefore science and technology makes it even more difficult to preserve the marriage together, preserve the intimacy of the family, the intimacy of the child that comes, that is born. Not they don't want that all pretty and planted in the womb. But that is what is happening. And over the world is all the embryos that are not used. And embryos are babies. They are destroyed. They are killed. And we're going to come to a stage of eugenics where only the best embryos, and which is now happening, and those who do IVF, only the best embryo will be used. So we are creating a world of supermen and superwomen. If you are of poor genes, better don't go. Look for the good genes. So if your wife poor genes, husband poor genes, get a good genes. You become a genius. And so this is the world we are talking about. Manipulation of the sacredness of life. And the family. That is why today the world is promoting, you know, transgender things, and all these things are pressure. Because they want to normalize what is abnormal. And you are hearing this every day from the social media, from TV. Everybody is saying it is normal. Now, if you think otherwise, you are abnormal. So now the church is abnormal. Now I am abnormal. You know, I don't think the way the world is thinking. But you know, my dear brothers and sisters, the real threat is internal, it's not external. This is why King Archelaus, we are told that Joseph was afraid when he assumed power, he went to Nazareth. And so we are fearful. Instead of listening to the word of God as the response to someone else's, blessed are those who fear the Lord, he will be blessed. So he told us, let the word of God be enriched in your house, in your heart, praying together, sharing the wisdom together, in prayers, in worship. Do we do that? Most of our Catholics today, they don't listen to the church, they don't read the word of God. They want to subscribe to the values of the world. They call themselves Catholics, but I tell you, these are baptized babies. They're not Catholics. Catholics believe in the word of God. We take the word of God seriously. We also subscribe to the values of the world, and most Catholics are doing that. In church, they are Catholics. Outside the church, they are pagans. Because the values are not Catholic values. They are not values founded on the word. Because we are fearful. Because otherwise, people think that we are abnormal.
sure this is what we are supposed to do in relativism. Everybody is right. So, my dear brothers and sisters, in the face of these challenges, what do we do? That is why you must turn to the Holy Family. It's called holy. Not just holy, precisely because Mary and Joseph gave the kind of ambience to Jesus to grow, to help him fulfill his vocation in life. Every parent is to search the will of God for themselves and for their children. That's what Mary and Joseph did. The kind of ambience they gave to Joseph, to Jesus, to grow up with. And who helped him? Mary and Joseph, they lived a beautiful life of love, of celebration. Saint Joseph taught Jesus the importance of work, the dignity of work, humble, responsible work, not just for economic gains, but for the good of humanity. We don't just work in order to make money. We work as a contribution to our fellow. That is the true meaning of work. It's not just about money alone. It is about our dignity and how we grow in the service of others. And what is the secret? As the second reading tells us, because Jesus reigned in their hearts. God reigned in their hearts. Mary and Joseph, they were contemplating. They were always praying, discerning, listening to the word of God. How many of you parents? You are supposed to be the people who have to guide your children. Do you pray? Do you have silence in your mind? Do you have solitude? You don't pray, you don't read the word of God. How can you lead your children? The blinding, the blind, all according to the teach. Mary and Joseph, they were always making time to pray, to listen, and to ask what does the Lord want of them. That is the reason why they were able to lead their life that with peace and bring that security into their family. So my dear brothers and sisters, you know, let us be encouraged today as we set the feast of the Holy Family. I know family life is difficult. It is challenging. Husband and wife today, you know, both are husband and wife are both are equally intelligent. Sometimes the wife is not more intelligent than the man, you know. And you have problems, you know. And then you want to listen to one another. And people start fighting. So these are other issues today. The modern life is very different from the life of our parents. It's a very different setup, different lifestyle. But yet, we are called to learn, to grow in love. And this is where the domestic family, you need the bigger family, you need the community of faith. You cannot journey alone, you cannot walk alone, because there will be trials in our life, and when the trials comes in, if you don't have a community to support you in faith, you will lose your faith. When tragedy is right, faith will disappear. This is why you know. I have said it many, many times, and I keep on repeating. Every Catholic must belong to a faith community. Whether it's a Catholic neighborhood group, whether it is the ministry, or some communities, where you can share the word of God together, where you can share your faith together, where you can pray together, worship together. That's how we grow. Any Catholic without a faith community, is at risk, because no man is an island. We are called to be the body of Christ. That is why, especially particularly, and I say it again, young people, the reason why many young people are leaving the church, simply because the community they found is not inside the church. It is in the world, it is in the mall, it is the shopping center. It is not in the church. If we want to retain our young people, we need to give them a community. So my dear brothers and sisters, the Feast of the Holy Family really celebrates a community growing in love together, but always in the world, and we want to.